Hey everyone, Shabby Gamer here, and welcome back to the WWE 2K15 Universe Mode, and this, which is our next episode of the Attitude Era's Friday Night Raw is War. And as you can see by the calendar here, we have our next pay-per-view next week, which will be Unforgiven. So let's have a quick look at the card I've got set for you this evening. We're going to start things off with a tag team number one contenders match. We'll see the NWO's Kevin Nash and Scott Hall taking on the Acolytes, JBL and Ron Simmons. The winner of this match will go on to face the tag team champions Evolution, Batista and Randy Orton at Unforgiven next Sunday in a First Blood elimination match. Next, we're going to see the Clash of the Titans as Mark Henry faces off against The Big Show. Hollywood Hulk Hogan faces off against Stone Cold Steve Austin in an Extreme Rules match. CM Punk takes on Brock Lesnar again in an Extreme Rules match. And our main event this evening sees Shawn Michaels, the current WWF champion, taking on the number one contender for the Intercontinental Championship, Kane. So without further ado, let's get straight into our first match of the evening. And as I said, that first match will be the Outsiders, Kevin Nash and Scott Hall, taking on the Acolytes, JBL and Farouk. And here we go, we're going to start off with Kevin Nash and JBL in the ring. Of course, we have the Outsiders, the former tag team champions here in this Universe Mode. Lost the belts to Edge and Christian, it was. Who later on, of course, lost the belts to the last pay-per-view to Evolution. So there's been a lot of movement in this tag team division over the last few months. And both these teams will be hoping that they can add to that at Unforgiven. But of course, they need to get past each other here this evening. And great work there by Scott Hall, just pulling JBL back and allowing Kevin Nash to slap him around the face. Insult there by Kevin Nash, adding to the injury already inflicted. And I have seen something today actually that I just wanted to share with you quickly on 2K16. It was mentioned a few guys have had hands on a little go with the game, and they have said that there are four different Stone Cold Steve Austin models on the game. Four separate Stone Cold Steve Austin characters, I mean. And that intrigued me now, because it makes me wonder if we are going to have several of other characters, several Triple H's and several, several Mark Henrys like we have on this game. We've got several Kanes, of course, that have been already mentioned. So it's a possibility there are going to be a lot more than the 120 characters on the game. Of course, some of them might be duplicates, but still, there's going to be a lot more than what we originally figured. I think he said there was Stunning Steve Austin, Superstar Steve Austin, just plain Steve Austin, and then Stone Cold Steve Austin as well. So four different variations is what's being mentioned, and that'll help us in our Universe Mode just to try and make things look a bit better. Scott Hall with a pin only for a one count. I think there was Stunning Steve Austin is obviously the original blonde hair one. You've got Superstar Steve Austin, which I'm not sure when that was. I think it might be his ECW part. There is Stone Cold Steve Austin from the Attitude Era, and then there's a newer Stone Cold Steve Austin as he would look and feel now. So again, yeah, like I say, it's interesting. And by it, it's really good to have the up-to-date Stone Cold Steve Austin, because it means we can run a little storyline here and there where Austin comes back into the main roster, maybe has himself a feud. Again, we'll have to see how that pans out as we go along. One of the people I'm really excited about having on the game, and some people might not have thought about this one as much as I have, but Shane McMahon. Shane McMahon is an absolute immense wrestler. They should really do a DVD of the best of Shane McMahon's matches, because there wasn't a single match that guy put on that wasn't five star. He was absolutely immense. He really was. I remember matches against Steve Blackman. That match against Kurt Angle at SummerSlam where he was belly to belly through the glass. That was one of the best matches I've seen. And of course, one of my favourite matches of all time was Shane McMahon versus Vince McMahon at WrestleMania. In the street fight, that was an incredible match. That was, and I'll definitely be using both those guys in the Universe Mode. Of course, not as normal wrestlers. We're not going to see Shane McMahon go in every single week for the championships. We're not going to see Vince McMahon going in for the European Championship at any point in time. Don't get me wrong, but we will be doing maybe a little feud here and there that culminates in Vince McMahon having a match at a major pay per view. Be very interesting. Of course, we could also have a sort of a chosen one for Vince McMahon. Big clothesline there by Farouk, and Scott Hall looks out here. Farouk with the pin, one, two. Oh, that's lucky enough, because Nash was very, very slow across the ring. I don't think he would have made it there in time. He's got Hall now twisting the arm of Faruka. Goes down hard and Hall pulling Faruka into the middle of the ring. Going to go for a pin himself. One. Only a one count. Faruk kicks out straight away. And of course, Faruk will be on the game next year, as will Scott Hall. All four of these guys are on the game next year as full members of the roster. Of course, I think Scott Hall is downloadable content. But of course, I say Faruk is on the game, but Faruk is on the game not as his APA attire. He's going to be on the game as, obviously, Faruk from the Nation of Domination, part of the showcase, that is. And I've heard a lot of people complaining about some of the people on the wrong game, saying, oh, it's really random. Why would you have Savio Vega, but you not have this guy? Why would you have this guy, but not this guy? And it's because, simply, Savio Vega is part of the showcase. They've not put Savio Vega on there because he's better than somebody else. They've put him on there because he generally has a use in the showcase. And that's the main reason why. It's the same with Mikey Whipwreck. They are, oh, why would you put Mikey Whipwreck of all the ECW guys you could put in onto the game? It's because Mikey Whipwreck is part of the showcase with Austin. That's the main reason. They're not saying that Mikey Whipwreck is a better wrestler than Tommy Dreamer, for example, or Sabu, or Rob Van Dam, or anyone like that. They're just saying that Mikey Whipwreck had an influence on Austin's career, whereas the other guys didn't. Well, they might have had an influence on his career, but not as much as what Whipwreck did, since, obviously, Austin stole Whipwreck's finisher. That's where he got his stunner from. JBL in the ring now, and Kevin Nash brings Scott Hall back in as well. Headlock here by JBL and whipping Scott Hall into the corner of the Acolytes, and follows up with a big clothesline in the corner. Scott Hall goes down hard. JBL going for the pin. One, two, and that's it. Faruk takes Kevin Nash out of it, and the Acolytes are making their way to Bloodground to face off against the Evolution in that tag team elimination first blood match. I have to make sure you can actually do a first blood match elimination. I'm not actually looked to tell the truth, but I'm pretty sure you can. It makes sense. There was a big clothesline from hell there by Faruk, and there was a double powerbomb, a triple powerbomb, sorry, on Kevin Nash, and that's a hell of a feat of strength that was by Faruk. But as you see, Kevin Nash is very, very slow across the ring. Faruk managed to get there in time to block Nash off, allowing Bradshaw the time to get the freak out, and the Acolytes are going on. And you must think that a first blood hardcore style match is going to be really in favour, really. This is what they're good at. So as you see, they're very happy. They're going to go on to Unforgiven, which of course is next Sunday. Be sure to check that one out. There will be three or four. There'll be four tag team. There'll be four championships on the line, including the tag team championships, of course. And our second match here this evening is the Clash of the Titans. It's Mark Henry versus The Big Show. Okay, Big Show, Mark Henry. Who's going to come out on top of this one? Of course, both big men here. And over the years, I think they've feuded. They've teamed up together. They're too well. The Big Show is probably the worst one. He turns more than and something that turns a lot. What turns a lot? A windmill? He turns one the way. I don't bloody know. You know what I mean. He's been turned face and heel that many times. It's become... it was boring to start with, but it's come even worse now. We don't know where to stand with Big Show, really. Mark Henry. Mark Henry's been out of it for a long time now. I think he's been struggling with injuries over the last year or so. And, of course, both these guys now have been in WWE for such a long time, you can expect that the injuries are starting to take toll. It's a shame, really. Well, it's not really a shame, but they've had their time. It's come, it's passed, I think, now. Unfortunately, the new breed of WWE superstar is coming in from NXT, and I think that some of these guys should really start to bow out gracefully now. You don't want to end up being there just for so long that you end up ruining your own reputation by just sticking around too long. This happened a lot with footballers in the UK. You see these footballers that are just, they want to cling on to their careers for as long as possible, to the point where they may start themselves like a little bit stupid, really, because they've just declined that much at what they do that they're just not as good anymore. As Mark Henry just gets thrown across the ring by the Big Show. Henry back up to his feet, but Big Show continuing the assault. Big Show's dominating Mark Henry here. Of course, we do still have one more slot to fill on our Bloodground pay-per-view. Not quite sure what to do with it as of yet. I have one idea actually, and I think I may go ahead with that. And it's gonna be a big surprise for everybody. And hopefully, I'll do that. Yeah, I had one thing I wanted to do anyway, so it will happen. At Blood Ground, so be sure to check that out. It's gonna be a big one. It's gonna be really exciting. I promise you that it's gonna be very exciting. I've been looking forward to doing this now for a long time. But I've never really had the right opportunity to do it, and now I've got space on the card. I think it's definitely a time that we do this. So like I say, be sure to check out Blood Ground. Yeah, it is Blood Ground, it's not Unforgiven, it's Blood Ground. It's the pay-per-view suggested by Kenny a few weeks back. It is essentially a pay-per-view based around first blood matches and that sort. So we do have our tag team championship as a first blood match. We're going to have Hogan versus Austin in the first blood match as well. And then we're going to have Extreme Rules matches and stuff like that. Basically, there's going to be a lot of blood involved in the pay-per-view, I should imagine. And that's taking place next Sunday. The problem is I haven't got an arena or a logo for it as of yet, which is why it's still shown as Unforgiven on the calendar. Now, Mark Henry, I thought he was going to try and lock in a camel clutch, but instead just dropping his body weight on the lower back of the Big Show. Henry now brings Big Show back up to his feet, and there's no way. Yep, you saw that. Mark Henry got Big Show up for a powerbomb, and Big Show reversed it into a face crusher. And now Big Show moving faster than I've ever seen him move before in my entire life. Whatever happened to the physics on this game? I think they did start doing it where guys of a certain weight couldn't pick up other guys of a certain weight, if that makes sense. So Rey Mysterio could never pick up the Big Show, but that doesn't seem to affect it in this game anymore. I don't know if I've just turned one of the settings off or what, but I'm sure that used to be a thing. As Big Show just walking across the chest of Mark Henry. What the hell just happened? When did Big Show ever use that move in his entire life? Big Show can't get his legs that high, surely. Go for the pin. Two. Only a two count. Mark Henry kicks out. Big Show's launching Mark Henry over the top of the ropes there. Mark Henry crashing down hard onto the mat below, and Big Show comes out to join him. Mark Henry just throwing the Big Show at the top of his head here, and Big Show hits that ground hard on the outside. Mark Henry into the power slam onto the ring steps. Big Show that knee to the stomach and now slides back in the ring. Mark Henry looks a little bit shaken on his feet. Takes a few extra seconds to get back in the ring. Big Show now signaling for this big knockout punch, and he does. Mark Henry's down, but is he out? Mark Henry's been busted open as well. Big Show for the pin. One, two, and three it is. The Big Show victorious here over Mark Henry. There was a pin earlier on in the match. It was only for a two count. To the point where obviously Big Show had been throwing Mark Henry over the top rope, and now Mark Henry throwing Big Show at the top of his head. And the replays in this game are absolutely dire. They really, we missed all the action. And we are actually going to see the finishing maneuver here by Big Show. This is the point that busted the Mark Henry open. And there's the three count. One, two, and three. Big Show victorious here. Match doesn't really mean a hell of a lot, but of course we've got one more pay-per-view after Blood Ground. Next Sunday we've got one more pay-per-view left, and that'll be the Great American Bash. Again, suggested by Kenny a few weeks back. He wanted to see it, and we are going to bring it back. Maybe Big Show can get himself on the card for that next pay-per-view. Who knows? Have to see how things pan out. Maybe we can involve him in a feud. And our next match this evening will be an Extreme Rules match between Hollywood Hulk Hogan and Stone Cold Steve Austin. And Hogan offering a handshake here at the beginning of the match. Is Austin? No, Austin wasn't sure on taking it, and he was right not to. As Hogan with the early low blow. Austin went down, and now Hogan trying to capitalize on this early advantage he's taken. Wrenching back at the arm of Stone Cold Steve Austin. And of course, these two guys will face off at Bloodground next week. This was the feud suggested by Kenny at the pay-per-view suggested by Kenny. And obviously, we're going to use the gimmick of the pay-per-view, the first blood match between these two. Again, it will be an Extreme Rules match as well, but no pinfalls, no submissions. This match will only end when one of these two guys is busted open, which, as we've seen in the past, can happen very, very quickly on this game. Only takes one or two quick hits with the old weaponry to get there. Hogan with a big punch to the head of Austin. Austin now with a belly-to-belly slam on Hollywood Hulk Hogan. Hogan has been heavily involved in this universe mode. Tell the truth, at the beginning, when we first started the Attitude Era, I didn't expect Hogan to be involved this much. He sort of forced his way in early on, made himself into a feud with Sting. It wasn't something we set up. He just attacked Sting during the entrance of his debut match here on the Attitude Era. So that built up our feud, obviously, between them two. I think he then had a feud against The Rock. He also had a feud against The Ultimate Warrior. Now he's had a feud against Austin. So Hogan has been heavily used in this universe mode. I think out of the 6 months we probably will get through, he's going to be feuding in four of those months. So he's really had a great time. Guys like The Rock and Austin and Triple H haven't been seen that often. See Austin there wrenching back at the arm of Hogan. And of course, just a quick plug, Retro Roster's Starrcade will be uploaded this Sunday, and that is the finale episode. Once the episode is finished, we are done for Retro, so be sure to check that one out. You can check out the description below and you will find a link to all of the playlists I'm currently running in this universe mode. So if you click on Retro, like I say, the last ever episode of Retro Roster on 2K15 will be uploaded on Sunday. And then hopefully that'll speed us up recording the rest of these shows, in theory. Of course, we've got Bloodground next weekend, and then we've got Combat Zone Wrestling the weekend after. But I'm hoping, of course, because of 2K16 coming out in 2 weeks tomorrow, or 2 weeks today, actually, I've got a hell of a lot of recording and uploading to do. I really have. I don't think I've realised just how much I've got to do. And it's really starting to hit me now, and I'm panicking. I'm really, really panicking. Of course, we've only got about two or three episodes left of Combat Zone Wrestling as well before that one's done. But like I say, as soon as we start to knock a few of these episodes out, a few of these finales out, then it's going to become quicker to record the rest. And one thing I will also say as well is that if it gets to 2K16 and I haven't got as far as the finale pay-per-view, I will just skip the weekly shows and just go straight into the finale. I want to get this all done and finished before 2K16 comes out, so we can just seamlessly go straight into uploading the 2K16 footage. Which also reminds me, I need to get the whole thing wired up first. And I've not tried to record off the PlayStation 4 yet on the Elgato gaming card, so I'm hoping that it is going to work cleanly without any extras. I think I need to download a bit of new software. I think that's all. Then everything should be good to go, I believe. Hogan now with a baseball bat, but swings it, and Austin catches it. And Austin tries to swing it back at Hogan, but Hogan punching Austin to the point where he drops that bat. Austin now slides back outside the ring to join Hogan. Looking under the ring for a weapon, but again, Hogan has caught him. Oh, and Hogan with the hip toss, sending Austin straight through the announce table. And at least because that was a hip toss, at least we will definitely get a replay of that one. And now Hogan DDT'd onto the debris of the announce table by Austin. And this match has all of a sudden got a lot more vicious than it was a few minutes ago. Russian leg sweep now by Hogan on Austin. As the elbow drops the inside of the leg now by Hogan, working on them braced knees of Austin. Of course, he's had problems with those in the past, both of them, which is why they're so heavily metal braced. Neck breaker now by Hogan on Austin. And of course, Hogan got the early advantage in this match with that cheeky low blow. But then since then, it's been a pretty even match. Both guys have enjoyed some aggression. Now again, Austin, this time he got the chair out, but Hogan caught him just as he was pulling it out. Austin with a clubbing blow across the back of Hogan. And of course, we're going to have to download Hogan next year. I'm not sure if he's going to be in the Attitude Era or not. We might just keep him solely to retro. Not sure yet. Might have him make a few... I think they'll have him as a permanent member of the retro roster and then maybe have him make the odd appearance here and there in Attitude Era and even current day as well. Don't think we'll have two separate Hogan cores. It seems a bit pointless to have two separate ones because you only get 100 spaces, so I'm going to use all them 100 spaces quite easily. So I need to try and be a bit clever with the people that I do download. I'm trying to make sure the guys that I do download I can use across various rosters. Austin there with a stunner on Hogan. But of course, in Extreme Rules, the pinfalls and submissions inside the ring count. So Austin really needs to get him in there. But Austin went for some more. Went for some more damage there. And Hogan reversed it into that DDT. Hogan bringing Austin back up to his feet. And now he's going to go for a scoop slam. But Austin reverses and go for a backbreaker. Austin now with very, very poor AI trying to get to that ring to get a weapon, even though the chair's there on the floor that he could just pick up and use. Austin now throwing Hogan back into the ring. And of course, like I say, Hogan's taking a lot of damage. As is Austin. Austin's taking a lot of damage as well. So I think this match must be close to an end. But both these guys need to be in the ring. And Austin chooses against it. Hogan comes back out to join him. Now Austin looks like he's going to... Just why? Just the AI is terrible. It really is. It's really bad. The battle continues on the outside, and I can't wait for 2K16 to come out just to try and get an improvement on the entire game. Of course, it's going to be a massive improvement for me because not only will it be a new year's game, it'll be a new platform. I've not used to the WWE games on the PS4 yet, so for me it's going to be a big, big difference, and it's going to be a great... improvement for all of us, not just me, for obviously for the episodes we upload as well. Well, hopefully there'll be less crashes. Hopefully there will be a much better universe mode as well. But of course, we don't know about the universe mode yet. Why hasn't Austin gone for a pin there? Hogan's taken a lot of damage, and Austin sends his trash can into the ring. Now Hogan thought he was going to try and catch Austin there. Austin going for the pin. Only for a two count. Thank God for that. Would have been a terrible finish to this match. Rake to the eyes by Hogan. There's a big elbow drop as well. In that sort of situation, you normally see Hogan like to go for his leg drop. He seems to be holding off. Austin is down. I don't know why he hasn't gone for it, but he's going to go for the pin after that neck breaker. Of course, Austin's had problems with the neck in the past, and that was very, very close to a freak out by Hogan on Austin. Austin now with a belly-to-belly slam on Hogan. I thought Austin was going to go for a leg drop there himself, but he went for the double deuces. And that was enough. Austin picks up the victory here over Hogan. Of course, they will face off again next week at Bloodground on the pay-per-view. But that will be a first blood match, that will. And I'm surprised there was no blood in this match. There was a lot of violence. There's a hip toss through the announce table by Hogan on Austin. There's the stunner as well on the outside by Austin. There was a pin from Hogan after, I think that was after the elbow drop. No, it was after the neck breaker, sorry. So close to a free count. And then Austin after the double... elbows, the double hell yes, picks up the victory, and he has taken even more momentum towards Bloodground. Of course, we do have one more episode of Raw is War for you before that pay-per-view. It'll be uploaded next Friday at the latest. There's a chance it'll be uploaded earlier. I'm not going to promise anything, but there's a chance that'll be uploaded earlier. I'm hoping there could be a chance I could upload another full week on Sunday evening, Monday morning. I'm not 100% sure if I can get that done yet, but hopefully I'm going to get there. And we'll see if Austin can pick up any more momentum working towards Blood Ground, or maybe Hogan can get back in. And our next match here this evening will be another Extreme Rules match as CM Punk takes on Brock Lesnar. Oh, and Brock Lesnar attacking Punk during his entrance here. Lesnar picks up the early advantage. Again, Extreme Rules, no countouts, no disqualifications, but pinfalls and submissions must take place within the confines of the ring. And we've seen some epic battles between these two over the last few weeks. Of course, the war will culminate at Blood Ground. Not sure on the gimmick of this match yet. I've not plumbed it in as yet. I think I might have done as Extreme Rules at the moment. I've got down as Extreme Rules at the moment, but I don't know, it just doesn't seem like enough. I think these two guys have had a few Extreme Rules matches now, and I just don't know what the best way to go would be with these. I could go Hell in a Cell, but we've done a Hell in a Cell match before, and it didn't really do much, to tell the honest truth. It was just a normal match. I think it was Triple H versus Mankind early on, and yeah, like I said, there just wasn't anything to it. It was a Hell in a Cell match, yeah. The match took place in a cell, but the AI of the two guys didn't use the cell at all to the advantage, didn't use cell as a weapon. I didn't think they left the confines of the ring at all match. So, like I say, it's an interesting one. And it's a possibility, don't get me wrong. We might be able to use it. Maybe I just had one bad match, so we've got a few Hell in a Cell matches being used this month. The Cage of Death pay-per-view for Combat Zone Wrestling, the big finale episode, that's going to have a six-man Hell in a Cell match as the big main event, as we said. And WWE Hell in a Cell pay-per-view takes place this month as well, and that is going to be a six-man Hell in a Cell main event as well, so be sure to check that one out. We already know that John Cena will be defending his belt against Batista. No, it's not Batista, is it? He's defending against... Ryback and Randy Orton already. We know. We've still got three more guys to decide yet. We're going to have our more qualifiers this week on Monday Night Raw. And, of course, our six-man Hell in a Cell at Extreme... six-man Hell in a Cell at Cage of Death for Combat Zone Wrestling. That will be Caprice Coleman defending his heavyweight championship against the former champion Dean Ambrose, Adam Cole, Chris Hero, Biff Busick, and Ricochet. So that's going to be a very interesting match as well. And in both of those matches, I think I will be controlling one person just to try and make sure that the cell gets broken open and these guys can start to explore. So my commentary might be a little bit disjointed. I say that my commentary is normally disjointed, but in those two matches, it might be a bit worse because I'm trying to concentrate on what I'm doing at the same time. See a Punk there with a sledgehammer just assaulting Brock Lesnar. And there's one thing I would like to if 2K could just improve the AI to use the environment a bit better. I know it does to a point. A lot of people use the oh my god moment, the DDT on the apron, they use the announce table and the ring steps and the corner barrier as well, but like certain things like in Extreme Rules, I've made the comment, Extreme Rules matches, there's tables under the ring. And at the moment, if they pull a table out, they generally try and use it as a weapon, just swinging it. And I think the AI should be there to try and put your opponent through the table as part of the match, rather than just using the table as a blunt weapon you can swing. If they use the table as an actual table, it may be a lot more effective. And the same with Hell in a Cell. If you're locked inside the Hell in a Cell, I think that people should try to use the cell to their advantage, throwing other people into the cell and trying to break through the cell and stuff like that. And I think that will definitely be the best way forward. And maybe instead of using the oh my god moment to get through the cell door, maybe what they should do is they should just allow you to keep working on a certain portion of the cell. So just keep to make two or three sections of the cell like breakable, and then you have to keep throwing your opponent against them over and over and over again before they finally snap open. I think that'd be the best way to go forward. But like I say, I just want them to be able to use their environment a bit better. Like, see, Lesnar has a table, he just swings it at CM Punk, and I want Lesnar to bring that table into the ring and then try and put CM Punk through the table. That's what I want to see. And it doesn't happen in these Extreme Rules matches. And if they can't do that, then why not just remove the table altogether from Extreme Rules matches, because it just seems pointless to use it as a blunt weapon. I'm sure if it's one versus one people playing, then that's not a problem. You can put them through the table, but AI-wise, just doesn't seem to work. Back elbow by CM Punk, and goes to the running kick, but Lesnar avoids it and picks that table back up and uses the weapon again. And I really wish Lesnar would grab a different weapon. Grab the ring steps, Lesnar. That's more your style, ring steps. Oh, Punk has Lesnar up on the outside. Not the greatest idea, though. There's the GTS. And, of course, now Punk has to try and do something. He has to try and capitalise on the damage done. But, of course, pinfalls and submissions only count inside the ring. Even if Brock Lesnar was to tap here, it wouldn't make any difference whatsoever. In fact, Lesnar actually breaks out the submission. I think Punk's lower leg and shin actually hit them ring steps as well. Punk picks up the ring steps as Lesnar stands there and watches, of course, as you do. And Punk continues assault on the outside. But again, he needs to get Lesnar back in the ring and take advantage of the damage done. See Lesnar just shoulder blocking the ring steps, knocking Punk straight down. And Lesnar just throwing Punk's face into the mat. I thought he was going to hit the ring steps again there. Lesnar throwing Punk into that ring post. Oh, we're going to get one of the Oh My God moments I haven't seen here, I think. Yes, the big boot. The big boot into the turnbuckle post. I've not seen that one before. In all my time of recording this universe mode, I've not seen anybody use that Oh My God moment. And I'm happy it was in this match, because it makes a lot of sense in this match. These two always put on fantastic matches. One of my favourite... Oh, the ring steps have turned over. I've not seen that before, either. Yeah, it's a real... These guys really put on some fantastic matches over the years. They had a lot of great chemistry in the ring. Lesnar with a German suplex on the outside. Trying to take CM Punk to Suplex City. Punk now with that suplex. Bringing Brock Lesnar back up to his feet. But Lesnar throwing Punk back into the ring. And both these guys doing a lot of damage to each other now. And surely the end is nigh for one of them. Both guys back in the ring for the first time in a long time. Lesnar swinging the trash can, but Punk catches it and now continues to assault Lesnar with that trash can. Or if you're English like me, the bin. Swinging a bin. Punk going for the pin. After hitting with the bin. Two. Only a two count. Punk throwing Lesnar into the corner. There's the bulldog into the big knee into the bulldog. And I think Punk actually tripped over the sledgehammer, believe it or not. Yeah, that just happened. Punk tripped over a sledgehammer. He fell over the sledgehammer. Punk with a pin. One, two. And again, only a two count. So close to a three, though, after that big kick. And this could be all, though. Punk takes Lesnar up for the second time in the match and hits the GTS again, and Brock Lesnar lands on the trash can and flattens it, and surely that is all, and it is. CM Punk victorious here over Brock Lesnar. And this is one of the early exchanges, and this is the first time that Punk visited Suplex City in the match. And here it is again. Look, he trips over the sledgehammer. I'm sure he does. There he is. And there you go. Well, there he goes. That was only for a two count, though. And the GTS here, you see, as he drops Lesnar, Lesnar falls onto that trash can and flattens it. Insult to injury, that is. And there's the three count. CM Punk victorious once again. And like I say, we'll see these two guys face off again at Bloodground next Sunday. Still trying to iron out what sort of gimmick we should do. But I'm thinking maybe we should have another go at Hell in a Cell. Maybe a Hell in a Cell first blood match. Maybe just to spice it up a little bit. And our main event here this evening will be the WWF Champion, Shawn Michaels, taking on the Intercontinental Championship number one contender, Kane. And here we go. Both these guys will be heavily involved at Bloodground next weekend. And of course, Shawn Michaels defending his WWF Championship against The Rock, as we found out last week. And as again we found out last week, Kane will be challenging Goldust for the Intercontinental Championship. So, big night for both these guys. Going to be involved in both the main event and, of course, the Upper Mid-Card Championship as well. There was a point last week where Kane could have actually been fighting for both the Intercontinental Championship and the WWF Championship next week. But of course, Kane was involved in that fatal four-way elimination main event. I think it was The Rock, it was Kane, it was Ric Flair. And there was somebody else there as well, I can't remember who it was now. But of course, it was The Rock who came out on top. Kane won the Intercontinental Championship, number one contendership, triple threat match against Shelton Benjamin and... God, my memory's terrible. It was only last week I recorded that episode. But of course, there are a lot of episodes I've recorded in this last week. If you haven't seen, I've also uploaded as extras where the Global Force Wrestling Junior Heavyweight Tag Team Championship Tournament. That was a couple of episodes that went across. And we also did the Ring of Honor Television Championship Number One Contendership Tournament to crown our number one contender for our big finale episode in 4 weeks' time. That, of course, was won by Jay Lethal. But apart from that, I could not remember who else it was in this match. It was definitely Shelton Benjamin. And it may have been Edge. I might be wrong. I probably am wrong. I don't know. I am lost. But of course, yeah. I've got my pad here. I can tell you it definitely was in the main. It was Sting. It was The Rock versus Sting versus Flair versus Kane. And the winner went on to face off against Shawn Michaels at Bloodground. And of course, that was again suggested, that match, by Kenny in the comment section below. Just proves that I do read your comments. I do try and reply to them all. And of course, if you have any ideas or any suggestions, please let me know. I will try and work them all in, not to give you a shout out in the process as well. Then the same thing for Tabby Gamer recently. He had the suggestion of bringing in the Motor City Machine Guns, and we brought them in this week for their debut on Global Force Wrestling. And they actually walked out with the Junior Heavyweight Tag Team Championships on their debut. A very, very quick match. And of course, thanks for Tabby again for that suggestion. He did get a shout out on Global Force Wrestling. And it was a great idea, and as it proved, as they won the Tag Team Championships on their debuts. Kane thrown over the top rope there by Shawn Michaels, who now follows him to the outside. And Michaels here with the spiked DDT on the apron on Kane. So Michaels got planned here. Now he's just looking at the fallen Kane. Kane back up to his feet. Both guys back into the ring now. And I think they can be... you guys can help me on this one. 2K15 on the PS4. Did you guys get casket matches? I think you did. I think they brought back the casket match for 2K15 on the PS4. So I'll be looking to hopefully get that as a match next year, because that'd be nice to do feuds with The Undertaker and Kane and involve sort of casket matches. Not even them. It can also involve Bray Wyatt in a casket match now. And with a case of a Global Force Wrestling, Mil Muertes, as we've seen as part of Lucha Underground, he's keen on a casket match every now and again, a good old Mil. So that's again another possibility of things we could do next year. As I said, I just want to know all the details. As soon as I get the game, I can just sit there and just plan. I can really, really plan it out. And I have got a full week off the second week in November. So I've got the first week of November at work. Then the second week, I've got the whole week off. Both weekends as well. So we're really going to blitz a lot of uploads that week. Of course, as I've already mentioned, that Fallout 4 comes out that week as well. So I'm not going to be constantly on this game. I will be uploading some Fallout 4 footage on top as well, which... hopefully some of you guys are interested in. If you are, then again, keep tuned to this channel. Subscribe if you're not already. And yeah, you'll see some great Fallout 4 footage, as well as all the 2K16 as well. And again, just to, for you guys as well, I'm going to do an extra playlist next year on 2K16. It's just going to be random matches. It's not going to be full events. just some random matches as Shawn Michaels with a quick roll up. Only for a one count. Yeah, just do some random matches and just upload the one-off matches. It could be things, it could be anything. So I've put a list together of things like Rey Mysterio versus Eddie Guerrero from Halloween Havoc in WCW. I'm going to do that as a one-off match. We'll do Dean Ambrose versus Brian Pillman. Undertaker Brock Lesnar. Undertaker Bray Wyatt. Shawn Michaels Triple H. The Rock versus Hogan. The Rock versus Cena. Cena versus Hogan. Like I said, any match. And if there's any matches you guys want to see, individual matches, please let me know in the comment section below. And of course, I will get them recorded as soon as the game comes out. Could be anything, any match type, anybody involved. Even if they're not on the game, let me know and I'll try and get them downloaded. So yeah, just let me know in the comment section below if there's anyone you'd like to see. And of course, when we upload the videos, you'll get a shout out as well. Okay, now the sidewalk slam on Shawn Michaels. Brings Michaels back into the middle of the ring. And we've seen Kane had some great results of recent times. A victory here of a Shawn Michaels would really put a cap on that. Unfortunately for Kane, he didn't win the number one contendership match last week, but well, for the WWF Championship anyway, he won the Intercontinental Championship one. Snake eyes by Shawn Michaels on Kane. Brings him back up to his feet. I just feel that Shawn Michaels might be going for that switch of music pretty soon, but oh, Kane's got Shawn Michaels up. Tombstone power driver by Kane on Shawn Michaels. One, two. Oh, word. Only a two count. How on earth is Shawn Michaels kicked out of that? Another sidewalk slam by Kane. And now Kane going for a camel clutch. He's got it locked in. Can Shawn Michaels fight out of this one? Or is it a case of live to fight another day for Shawn Michaels? Of course, he's defending his belt against The Rock next week at Blood Ground. The last thing he wants to do is to suffer any injuries here this evening. Only a one count there as Shawn Michaels rolled up Kane. And I still can't believe that Michaels kicked out the Tombstone Piledriver. If Kane had gone for the pin straight away after the Tombstone, like he normally does, I think he might have got it. But he hesitated a little bit. And I think that's cost him the victory here. Shawn Michaels now trying to take some control of this match. Oh, but Kane still comes back using his strength and his agility to come back and take control again. Again, only for a two count though. Michaels with the chops. And Kane again reversing with that. Whether that's an arm breaker or a DDT, not quite sure. Michaels had Kane up, but Kane reverses into that backbreaker. In for the pin now. One, two. And again, so close to a three count. How is Shawn Michaels staying in this one? And I can't imagine he's going to last for too long. That massive uppercut, and that could be all as well. And again, Shawn Michaels kicks out. Shawn Michaels with the knee to stomach, and there's the running forearm. Now Michaels trying to rebuild some momentum in this match. Going to go for the pin here on Kane. One, two. And again, now close to a free count for Michaels on Kane. Kane throwing Michaels into the corner. And Kane follows up that big corner clothesline, followed up by the leg drop. Brings Michaels back up to his feet via his throat. And there's a backbreaker by Kane. And it would just be amazing here if Kane could pick up the victory over Michaels. One, two. Again, only a two count. And there's Kane's sidewalk slam. And you know what? I think this is going to happen. One, two, and three. He has. Kane picks up the victory here over the WWF champion, Shawn Michaels. It took a lot of persistence, don't get me wrong. That Tombstone Piledriver earlier on. And this is the backbreaker. It's cut out a lot here, the game, as normal. Skipping some of the good stuff. And then here's the pin after the backbreaker. But followed it straight up here with a patented Kane sidewalk slam. And that was enough to finish Michaels off. And And there's the free count. Very, very interesting here. Kane victorious. Laughing away, but it's unfortunate for Kane. He didn't win the number one contendership match last week. We know The Rock is facing off against Shawn Michaels. Kane does have a shot against Goldust for the Intercontinental Championship. And if I'm Goldust, I'm backstage bricking it right now. I really am. And what a way to finish this episode. And as I say, that is all here this evening, guys. We've seen some great matches, seen some interesting results as well. If you could, thumbs up this video, absolutely fantastic. And of course, subscribing is 10 times better for me and for you. I've been Shabby Gamer. Thank you very much for watching. And I'll see you again in the next video.